Hello everyone. In this video tutorial, we are going to see types of instruments used in colorimetry and then applications of colorimetry. First of all, make it very clear students, colorimeter means the instrument and colorimetry means the process of colorimetric determination. Process of colorimetric determination is known as colorimetry and the instruments used for the process of colorimetry are known as colorimeters. In short, colorimeters means instrument and colorimeter means the process. So, first of all, we will see types of instruments used for the process of colorimetry. Here, I have given the title types, but there are basically three instruments which are used for the process of colorimetry. And in previous tutorial, we have already seen that colorimeter and spectrophotometer are the two majorly widely used instruments used for the process of colorimetry. Other than that, spectrocolorimeters are also used in colorimetry. So, three types of instruments are used for process of colorimetry. First is colorimeter, simple colorimeters, then spectrocolorimeters, and then spectrophotometers. Colorimeter is a basic and a simple instrument, then spectrocolorimeter is advanced than the colorimeters, and spectrophotometers are the most advanced instruments used for visible determination, means colorimetry, as well as UV determination. Most of all, spectrophotometers are UV visible spectrophotometers, means they work in the range of UV as well as in visible wavelength. So, now we will see the parameters, means basic difference between these three instruments. Radiation source, in previous tutorial we have seen basic components of the colorimeter, and basic, there are four components. First one is radiation source, then filter or monochromator, then sample holder, and then detectors. So, in colorimeter, tungsten lamp, in colorimeter and spectrocolorimeter, tungsten lamp is used as a radiation source. And in spectrophotometer, two radiation sources are used mostly. One is tungsten lamp and other lamp is deuterium lamp. Then, the monochromator, in colorimeter, absorption filters are used as monochromator. And spectrocolorimeter prism is used as a monochromator. And in spectrophotometer, grating is used as a monochromator. And we have seen that the efficiency of grating is more than the prism, and efficiency of prism is more than filters. Means filters, then prism, and then grating. Efficiency is in increasing order. Then detector, in colorimeter, photovoltaic cell is used as a detector. In spectrocolorimeter, PVC or photoemissive tubes are used as a detector. And in spectrophotometer, PMT, photomultiplier tube, is used as a detector. These is also, we have seen that efficiency of sensitivity of PVC is less than photoemissive tube, and sensitivity of photoemissive tube is less than photomultiplier tube. Means in spectrophotometer, all the components of highest efficiency and sensitivity are used, and that's why only spectrophotometer are most accurate and reliable than colorimeter and spectrocolorimeter. All of these instruments obviously measures percentage transmittance or absorbance done by sample. Then the recording or non-recording time. What it means? Recording means we can get our result and we can record our result in hard copy as well as in soft copy. And non-recording type means we cannot store our result. We just can note down the result from the display. In colorimeter are very simple instruments, so we cannot store its result. In colorimeter, we just can note down percentage transmittance or absorbance value which are displayed on the display button, right? In spectrocolorimeters, there may be recording type or non-recording type. Both types of spectrocolorimeters are available. And mostly they are single beam. We will see what is single beam and double beam instrument. And spectrophotometers are obviously of recording type. We can record our spectra and records absorption spectrum using plotter or recorder. Wavelength accuracy means bandwidth. In colorimeter, the bandwidth is plus or minus 30 nanometer, in spectrocolorimeter plus or minus 5 nanometer, and in spectrophotometer it is plus or minus 0.1 nanometer. This is bandwidth we have also seen in previous tutorial. So what does it mean? I am repeating, plus or minus 30 nanometer means if we want a lambda max of our compound is 500 nanometer, then we can get the radiation of the wavelength containing 470 nanometer to 530 nanometer, means plus 30 nanometer to 500 nanometer and minus 30 nanometer to 500 nanometer, that is known as bandwidth, right? So these are the basic components and parameters of these three instruments. Here in spectrophotometer, storage of spectrum, comparison of spectra, quantitative techniques, rapid wavelength scanning, data manipulation, derivative spectral mode, all of these things can also be present as an option in automated spectrophotometers, and they can be either microprocessor based or software driven using computer. And all of these things max wavelength accuracy of such automated spectrophotometers plus or minus 0.1 nanometer only. And so these automated spectrophotometers are more accurate and reliable than colorimeters and spectrocolorimeters. These are the pictures of colorimeter, spectrocolorimeter and spectrophotometer. Accuracy, sensitivity, reliability is in increasing order from colorimeter to spectrocolorimeter to spectrophotometer. Now, what does mean single beam and double beam instrument? We have seen that colorimeter and spectrocolorimeters are of single beam type only, and spectrophotometers can be either single beam or double beam. I am repeating, colorimeters and spectrocolorimeters are of single beam type only, and spectrophotometers can be either single beam or double beam type. And what does it mean by single beam instrument? Here see, beam means radiation, right? Radiation beam. Here in single beam instrument, focus on the sample holder students. In single beam instrument, there is one type of sample holder, and that is sample. And in double beam instrument, two sample holders are present. First one is reference and second one is sample. Reference means standard of our sample. If we are working with the paracetamol tablet, then the standard powder of paracetamol, pure standard powder of which purity is 95%, is known as reference of paracetamol. So in single beam instrument, the beam coming from the light source and passing through the monochromator reaches to the sample only. Here the sample only, the holder is of sample. And in double beam instrument, see, beam splitter M1 is known as beam splitter, which splits beam coming from the monochromator into two beams, one of which passes through a reference holder and second one passes through a sample holder. So here the beam is split into two beams, and that's why this instrument is known as double beam. And in single beam instrument, beam does not split, so they are known as single beam instrument, which means in single beam instrument they cannot compare our sample, but in double beam instrument we get result comparing with the reference. We can compare our sample with the reference, and the result we get from the determination by double beam instrument is the result of comparison between sample and reference compound. So in single beam instrument only sample is determined, and in double beam instrument sample is determined in comparison to its reference compound. And in double beam instrument, by using beam splitter, radiation beam coming from the monochromator is split into two beams, one of which passes through reference and second one passes through sample. And then the beams, after passing through reference and samples, are combined either combined. If there is one detector only, these beams are combined. And if two detectors individually are used, then it is not combined. So now you can understand, this is the components of single beam colorimeter. It consists of a tungsten lamp as a source of light, and this light radiation is focused onto a slit by using a concave mirror, and then this light passes through a simple absorption filter where only the required wavelength of light passes through it and falls onto the sample cell, where the solution to be analyzed is present in sample cell, and the sample solution absorbs a part of the radiation according to its capacity and characteristics, and the rest is transmitted, and then the intensity of the transmitted light or unabsorbed radiation is determined using a photovoltaic cell. We have seen that in colorimeter, photovoltaic cell is used as a detector, and using a digital display or a galvanometer type, we can get our result. Please, single beam colorimeters are simple in construction, and that's why they are inexpensive and easy to operate. These are the advantages: simple in construction and inexpensive and easy to operate. But the disadvantages are, the readings are greatly affected by the fluctuations in the intensity of radiation source, and the recorder cannot be used here with colorimeter, so we cannot record our result. We just can get a value. Now, this is the double beam colorimeter focused on the beam splitter students, which split the radiation coming from the filter, and the part of it passes through a sample cell and another part of it passes through a reference cell. And two detectors are displayed here. First one is for sample cell and second one is for reference cell. Other types of instruments are also there, where only one detector is used and the beams coming from sample and reference are combined, and then that beam reaches to the detector. And this case is also possible, where two individual detectors are used for sample as well as for reference cell. So this was single beam colorimeter, this is double beam colorimeter, and now this is double beam spectrophotometer, because single beam spectrophotometers are not used nowadays, so we are seeing double beam spectrophotometer. Here this figure component of this double beam spectrophotometer seems to be somewhat complicated, but there is nothing, only mirrors are there to maintain the direction of the radiation. More mirrors are used, and these mirrors makes this figure complicated. Let's start with the radiation source on the left side, which are tungsten as well as deuterium. I have said that in spectrophotometer, two radiation sources are used mostly, and one of which is tungsten lamp and other one is deuterium lamp. Then in spectrophotometer, as a monochromatic grating is used. First, radiation source from the radiation from the radiation source passing through the entrance mirror. See, it goes to the collimating mirror, then rotatable grating, and this grating makes the polychromatic light to monochromatic light. Then this monochromatic light through collimating mirror, through exit slit, through exit toroid mirror, reaches to the optical chopper. And this portion is known as monochromator. The whole of all of this portion is known as monochromator. Then optical chopper works as a beam splitter, which splits beam. Then reference toroid mirror and sample toroid mirror, through which beam reaches to the reference as well as sample covert. Then sample spherical mirror and reference compensator mirror are directed beams to the beam combiner. This beam combiner combines beams, and through which the radiation reaches to the detector. So this was the double beam spectrophotometer. Here is a monochromator gratings are used, and as a detector, photomultiplier tube is used. Because of their high accuracy, sensitivity, range, reliability and repeatability, double beam spectrophotometers are widely used than other types of colorimeters or instruments. So this was all about types of instruments used in colorimetry. Now moving towards applications of colorimetry. First application is quality control of purity, means qualitative analysis, then quantitative analysis, then determination of ligand metal ratio and metallic complexes, then structure elucidation of organic compounds, then determination of dissociation constant, means pKa value of indicators, determination of molecular weight of amines, determination of elements, ions, functional groups, determination of organic substances and pharmaceuticals, and spectrophotometric titrations. Most of these applications are of UV determination also, means UV spectroscopy also. So these are the applications of UV visible spectroscopy, or can say colorimetry, or can say UV spectroscopy. Qualitative analysis, quantitative analysis, ligand metal ratio, structure elucidation, dissociation constant pKa, then molecular weight, then elements, ions, functional groups, then organic substances and pharmaceuticals, and spectrophotometric titrations. Here major 9 applications are given. Let's see one by one. First one is quality control of purity. Colorimetry can be used to detect impurities present in the sample, and but here you have to know, mark one point. So impurities, color impurities can only be detected by the colorimetry. Non-color impurities cannot be detected by colorimetry, because non-color impurities will not absorb radiation of visible range. So color impurities present in a sample absorbs radiation of wavelength other than the wavelength of our compound, which gives rise to the disturbances. Here one example is taken of vitamin B12, which is known as cyanocobalamin, and cyanocobalamin has 3 lambda maxes, 278 nanometer, 361 nanometer and 550 nanometer. Then ratio of absorbance at 278 and 361 nanometer is 0.57, and ratio of absorbance at 550 and 361 nanometer is 0.3. This ratio is of pure cyanocobalamin. But if impurities are present in the sample of cyanocobalamin, this ratio of absorbances changes, and then we can detect the impurities. Second is quantitative analysis. For quantitative analysis of drugs by colorimetry, following characteristics must be known. First one is lambda max, then validity of Beer's law, means concentration range in which the system obeys linearity. This is, we have seen in Beer's law. For example, concentration range is 10 to 50 microgram per ml, or can 2 to 10 microgram per ml. And third characteristic is solvent, reagent and other conditions like E1 percentage 1 centimeter. If given in literature, it must be known by us of our compound under analysis. If these parameters we have, then we can perform quantitative analysis of our sample by colorimetry. Main two quantitative methods are there. First one is using E1 percentage 1 centimeter value, and second one is when this value is not available but reference standard is available. E1 percentage 1 centimeter value is used when reference standard is not available, and when reference standard is available but E1 percentage 1 centimeter value is not available, right? This value E1 percentage 1 centimeter is given in literatures like Pharmacopoeia and various journals. But if we cannot get this value of our sample, then we can use second B method. And this method B is further subdivided into two methods. First is single standard method or direct comparison method, and second is calibration curve method or multiple standard method. First method is using E1 percentage 1 centimeter value. First, make a mark, students. This value is given in pharmacopoeia or in various journals. And this method is used when reference standard of our sample is not available, because this method is less accurate than the B method. For example, this value of paracetamol at 257 nanometer is 715. This is given in Indian pharmacopoeia. So, we can find percentage purity of paracetamol by using the formula: percentage purity is equal to observed absorbance divided by E value multiplied by 100 by concentration. Here, the observed absorbance means we get by performing ultimately E value means 715 into 100 and divided by concentration means the concentration of our sample of which absorbance we are determining using ultimately. So, by using this formula, we can get percentage purity of our sample. Then the method B, when we cannot get this even percentage 1 centimeter value in any literature, this value means this is the absorbance of a solution having 1% weight by volume concentration, and 1 centimeter indicates the path length of the radiation means the internal distance of the covalent. So E1% 1 centimeter is not available in any literature of our compound, then but reference standard is available, then this method B is used, and this method B is more accurate than the method A. In this case, this value E1% 1 centimeter can be determined by observing the absorbance of different standard solutions, and the average E value is taken, and after calculating the E value, the method A can be followed. We can get this value E by preparing different standard solutions, because here reference standard is available. So we can get this value, average of this value, by preparing and measuring absorbance of different standard solutions, and then we can follow the method A. But if we do not want to follow method A, then we can follow other two methods. First one is single standard or direct comparison method, and second one is calibration curve method or multiple standard method. These two methods are practically on ground level most widely used methods to determine concentration or amount of any compound in spectroscopy. These two methods, single standard method or calibration curve method. First one is single standard method, which is also known as direct comparison method. We already know that combined Lambert-Beers law gives equation A is equal to E C T. E means absorptivity, C means concentration, and T means path length. Right? We have derived this equation in previous lectures. So here A1 is equal to EC1T and A2 is equal to EC2T, where 1 indicates standard and 2 indicates sample. A1 means absorbance of standard and A2 means absorbance of sample. A for standard, 2 for sample. C1 means concentration of standard and C2 means concentration of sample. E means molar extinction coefficient and T means path length. And in most of the instruments, this path length is 1 centimeter. So by dividing these two equations, we can get this equation A1 by A2. And finally, we can get the equation A1 by A2 is equal to C1 by C2. Right? And here, we already know the amount value of C1, A1 and A2. So we can calculate the fourth value of C2 can be calculated by using this equation. Here we can get absorbance of standard of standard solution, A2 means absorbance of sample solution, C1 concentration of standard we already know, and we want to determine C2. So we can get value of C2 by this equation A1 by A2 is equal to C1 by C2. Second method is calibration curve method, also known as multiple standard method. We have seen that graph of absorbance versus concentration is known as calibration curve or standard curve. And to prepare a standard curve, minimum 5 points must be there, means minimum 5 solutions must be there. And these solutions are in the range of Beers' law, means concentration range or linearity. And by interpolation or extrapolation, we can get the amount of our sample. These 5 points are get by the observations of standard solution students. Standard solutions. These are the results of standard solutions. Means we prepare these 5 solutions of 5, 10, 15, 20 and 25 microgram per ml. And we can get observations of these 5 solutions and then we plot this graph. Right? So this is the calibration curve or standard curve. Now we have one sample solution of which concentration we want to determine. So for example, absorbance of this sample solution is near to here 1.3. So this point should be extrapolate up to the linear line, up to the straight line of our calibration curve, and then the point where this line touches, we have to turn towards the x-axis, and on x-axis we can get the concentration. Here we can get, we can see that the concentration of our sample solution is near to 17 microgram per ml, right? So we just have to extrapolate after preparing calibration curve. Then third application is determination of ligand metal ratio in metallic complexes. Metals with some organic compounds forms metallic complexes, and the ratio of which can be determined, for example 1 is to 1, 2 is to 1 or 1 is to 2, can be determined by plotting curves using different ratios and observing the linearity of the curve similar to calibration curve. Then fourth is structure elucidation of organic compounds. By colorimetry, we cannot get accurate information about structure, but we can just get overview about the structure. We can propose that the structure of our sample is thin. We cannot confirm, we cannot say that this structure is confirmed. For that, UV, mass and NMR spectral IR, these types of spectroscopies are used. Here one example is taken, two structures 1 and 2 are proposed to be of tyrosine. But an absorption spectra of these two analogues are analogous, means similar to each other. But here the absorption spectra of compound 2 was similar to phenol, because here you can see the part of phenol in the structure of compound 2, and hence structure 2 can be proposed of tyrosine. Then fifth is determination of dissociation constant of indicators. You have studied in first semester that Henderson-Hazelbeck equation means pKa is equal to pH minus log concentration of ionized foam divided by concentration of unionized foam of a compound. This value of ionized and unionized foam concentrations of these two forms can be determined using colorimetry, and then plotting concentration versus absorbance at different pH, and using this equation we can get the dissociation constant value. Then determination of molecular weight of amines. And for that, first of all amines are converted into amine picrate, and then absorbance of these amine picrate solution is measured. And we already know that A is equal to ACT. Capital A indicates absorbance and small a indicates absorptivity. And for most of amine drugs, the value of molar extension coefficient is 30,400 at 380 nanometers. So putting that value, we can get the molecular weight. Then determination of elements, ions and functional groups. Using colorimetry, reagent or chromogen is used to produce color. Several amines, ions or functional groups can be determined quantitatively even at low concentration by using specific or non-specific color producing reagents, and these color producing reagents are known as chromogenic agents. Here reagent is chromogenic agents, means which are used to produce colors. You can see here for magnesium 8-quinol linol is used, for manganese periodate is used. Here lambda max and concentration range is also given. Then determination of organic substances and pharmaceuticals. Only few drugs are color. and most of the drugs in pharmaceuticals are non-colored, means bright or colorless. So we have to add chromogenic agent to produce color, and after that only we can perform colorimetry. But selection of chromogen plays a major role in colorimetry. It depends upon the functional groups present in the compound. For example, for phenolic function group, ferric ion is used as a chromogenic agent. Then for aromatic primary amine, diazotization coupling with N1 naphthyl ethylene diamine is used. For MnOSA, menhydrin is used as a chromogen. So by using these reagents, we can produce colors in the compounds having these functional groups. In pharmacopoeia, hundreds of drugs are given, and the other drugs are not official in pharmacopoeia, but here some examples are taken of which solvent, reagent and MDAMEX are officially pharmacopoeia. So by using this information, we can perform colorimetry to determine concentration or quantity or amount of a sample, drug or pharmaceutical compound. Then the last application of colorimetry is spectrophotometric titration. We know that titration is the reaction between titrate, means substance of which concentration is unknown, and the titrant, means the substance of which concentration is known. But here the condition is either titrate, means substance, or titrant, or the product resulted by the reaction between titrant and titrate must absorb the radiation in visible range. Obviously, then only we can perform colorimetry. Then Beer's law must be obeyed under the experimental conditions. Then titrant must be stronger enough so that error due to minor volume changes must be minimized. And the absorbance must be monitored at lambda max of substance or titrant or product, whichever have absorbing property. Here, examples of titration curves are given. First condition is when titrant only absorbs. So, up to the end point, we just get, first make it clear, student, titration means reaction between titrate and titrant, and by the reaction between titrate and titrant, we can get product. The end point means the reaction between titrant and titrate gets completed is known as end point. Right? So, the case where titrant only absorbs, in that case, first we get just straight baseline, and after end point we can get upward line, because after end point there is only titrant in the solution, so we can get upward line. Then the second case is where product only absorbs. So product is continuously increasing as the reaction proceeds. So first we get upward line, and then at the end point, means the product is resulted, after that the product cannot be produced. So after end point we get straight baseline. Then the third case where substance only absorbs. So as the titration proceeds, concentration of our substance decreasing. So we first get downward line, and after end point when the whole amount of substance is reacted, then just we get straight baseline. And the fourth case where titrant as well as titrate both absorbs, but product does not absorb. So first we get downward line and then we get upward line. So this was the applications of colorimetry, quantitative and qualitative analysis, then molecular weight, then dissociation constant, then determination of ions, elements, functional groups, and then spectrophotometric titration. Thank you.